Okay. So by my title, in many ways, the deep focus of this presentation is forest management, and specifically Anishinaabe forest management. This presentation today is a part of my larger dissertation, which does focus on the fur trade. But the way that I end up addressing that is thinking about that kind of unique power relationship between Anishinaabe people in Northern Michigan and the French. But I like to think about how that power articulates with the way that Anishinaabe interact with their landscape, the way that they care for their plant relatives, and how then that ends up being employed to help them resist coercion. So one of the questions in my dissertation revolves around intentional management of the landscape and whether or not we can detect that. And that is what we're going to focus on today. And just as a side note, I'm going to try to say forests as much as I can, because I do like to say woodlands to mean the woodlands, but it's also there's the woodland period. So I will try my best not to be confusing, but I am only human. So thank you. Okay. Here's our little roadmap real quick. First, I'm going to dive into thinking about forest management systems, then giving you the cultural context and the environmental concepts. Then we'll get into the nitty-gritty of the fieldwork, the site that I dug for my dissertation, the results, and then finally part three, thinking about insights and kind of the future work, but primarily how this work actually connects to contemporary indigenous movements and food sovereignty. So it was in the 1600s that Nicolas Duny was thinking about the landscape and the forests and writing about it. And he was one of many, you know, Europeans that would get this obsession with forests. What he ended up writing about was thinking about, okay, if we open up the forests and cut down a bunch of trees, somehow it will allow more light, and then that light will mean there'll be less snow. The problems with his, you know, logic notwithstanding, there were two assumptions that really stood out from this, which was first, he assumed that the environment was static. Second, he assumed that the environment was almost this like pure chaos, this concept of the forest and woods and nature as like wilderness and wild. He was wrong. The grand arrogance of his statement notwithstanding. Also, what he failed to realize, and when he was not the first and he will not be the last, was the role of indigenous people in the long-term caretaking and management of the ecosystems, whereby they, up until very recently in science, have been completely ignored for their role within what we think of as natural landscapes, and now have become kind of the focus of archaeological investigations as we try to harness archaeological work to think about contemporary issues like climate change or, you know, indigenous sovereignty, or trying to reconstruct environments back the way they were, because that means trying to learn about and harness the traditional ecological knowledge that was used to do these practices. So what this means is indigenous plant management. And ultimately, it's this kind of broad and diffuse niche construction that people across the globe have been doing. And I define it in like kind of three main sections. First, there's the management of your ecosystem that's promotional. So intentional management of either propagating or assisting certain wild species that people prefer either for spiritual or subsistence reasons. There's the second one, which most of us are familiar with because it's the cultivation of species, which ends up leading to domestication. So, you know, this is your agriculturalists. And third, we have kind of like resting and allowing spaces to kind of like go fallow for a while, collecting for a while and moving on. And the kind of seasonal rounds that people will have, where they'll move from season to season into different camps, can play a role in this sort of plant management system as one of the reasons for moving, so that there's chances for the landscape to breathe and regenerate. And oftentimes it is very purposeful. However, there is also another kind, which is rather than intentionally propagating species, using destruction and clearing as a way of promoting specific types of landscapes and ecology. And these are widely known as fire management systems. And the Anishinaabe use this, but also this is a system that across the United States has become of very, you know, intense interest as government agencies end up working along with tribal groups to use that traditional ecological knowledge and try to prevent devastating forest fires. So fire management systems, like I said, intentional burning. What it does is it burns off old growth areas, creates openings. It promotes the growth, at least in Michigan specifically, of berries and mushrooms, of oak trees that, and other nut-producing trees. Then those not only are, you know, really great food sources on their own, that then with that burning become at least three times more productive after a burning event, but also draws in a lot more prey species that then contribute to subsistence. In part, it works by clearing an understory, allowing more light. So species that are shade intolerant are able to, you know, take advantage of that. But it also kind of picks at and, you know, pushes the button of any fire adaptive plants to allow them to kind of take over and have an advantage. And there are a great deal of ethnographic descriptions of this, both contemporary and historical. And what we're seeing here are a few of the different outcomes and plants that are indicators that fire has been used. You know, eagle fern and wild geranium are two such plants that are very well known to be fire adaptive. And while they may not be the intent of a fire management system, the outcomes that they want are usually like the berries and, you know, nuts and what have you. But for the purposes of today, all of those together are very good evidence of that we'll be using. So some of the ethnographic discussions are primarily from Canada, but also trickle down into the Michigan area because the Anishinaabe are part of that larger group. I will show you a map of that. We'll put a pin in that. But there are pretty detailed descriptions from elders about burning events in the springtime to take advantage of the natural cycle of when plants are going to, you know, suddenly be germinating and growing. And so that will be the time that not only, you know, maple sugaring, but then burning off old stands and allowing it to kind of break up and create forest patches. And here I not only have a picture of a contemporary project that involves, I think, the DNR doing intentional burning and having Anishinaabe consultants on the project, but then also contemporary Anishinaabe artist Mario Peters. This is one of their paintings that is kind of pulling together teachings that elders taught him, and it's portraying a burning event in the spring. Don't ask me about the animals. I'm a plant person. But I can look it up later for you if you'd like to know. Point being that these are a part of larger socio-ecological relationships. So not only do these systems have a really important place in subsistence, they're also highly spiritual. They're very deeply connected with many other types of both political and, you know, medicine and other parts of people's kind of kinship systems as well, I should probably say, but they hold a place as a very important element of archaeological work. So here I just have, this is the work of Davison Hunt, where it's showing you, at least linguistically as well, the different forest concepts. So burning, using ishgode to create berry patches, and those have specific names. And then it's an entire kind of forest succession that's created through fire ecology. And I realized when I said kinship, I should probably explain that in the spiritual system, plant beings are thought of as relatives. So within this system, trying to think about it, if we're, you know, kind of applying theory, it means that people's relationships with the landscape are also them intentionally tending and trying to help their plant relatives. So ethnographically and contemporarily, big topic. But also in recent years, archaeology has started to turn its eye to this sort of topic and really think about how far back can we detect it? In what ways? What are all the permutations of managing the landscape? And in what contexts do they happen? And that is a huge interest of mine for thinking about the Anishinaabe and what they try to do and use the landscape for and their relationship with it. So these are just a few examples of some of the archaeological interest recently. So, you know, Canadian Journal of Forest Research, where there's contemporary work, but then also recently, the Midwestern Archaeological Society had an entire session dedicated to it. So this is where I enter the stage. So Anishinaabe, I should probably tell you all, is a larger kind of political term that's also kind of a name of an Algonquin language. So I'm going to primarily call the people of Northern Michigan just broadly Anishinaabe for today, but just so that everybody is aware, it is a cultural group that then is broken into three separate tribal kind of designations or divisions. So if you've ever heard of Ojibwe, Potawatomi, or Odawa, those are all Anishinaabe groups. And they are hunter-gatherer groups, primarily, seasonally mobile and patrilocal, except for the mobility aspect of it. And here's the map of, at least based on historical documents, where Ojibwe and kind of Ottawa territory overlapped. Today, Anishinaabe groups are all over Canada, north of Michigan, off into Wisconsin, and elsewhere, including Oklahoma for, historical reasons. But within Michigan, where I end up kind of putting my case study is in Drummond Island. So because, you guys are in Florida, figured I'd show you a map of Michigan where Drummond Island is. It's the tiny little island right there on the edge of the border of Canada and Michigan. These are two pictures actually from specifically Drummond Island, but more specifically the Cloudman site where I did my dissertation research. Zooming in. So the Cloudman site, it is a privately owned site, so I'm going to limit location information as much as possible, but it is kind of a protected area where it's easily accessible by canoe, but kind of shielded from storms, and is one of the sites, other than the Juntenin site in Michigan, that has multi-components that are very rich with data going all the way back to the middle Woodland period, all the way through to today. So thinking about Drummond Island, let me tell you a little bit about what we can expect in terms of the forest types. First and foremost, Drummond Island's on this like interesting border between boreal forests and like northern mesic. These are, obviously maps of contemporary forest areas, but first we have the boreal component that we could expect, where older stands of woods, if left completely on their own, tend to shift into conifer hardwood forests. But because this is also an island, importantly, they'll form these kind of linear bands around the edges of the island, so just off of the beach. So you don't kind of get as many huge stands of it, but they still are present and actually an important aspect of the soil formation. Second, and obviously today this is much more abundant, is the mesic northern forest. So this is your dominated by hardwoods, primarily sugar maple, and then American beech following that. This is the type of forest succession for old wood forest that south of the middle part of Michigan past the thumb is the common one. So most of the Midwest, your older forests are gonna be this like northern hardwood forest as opposed to the coniferous ones. But part of those associations are also some conifers where you have hemlock or white pine that are, associations in the canopy, but might not be the dominant species. So the Cloudman site, just some information. I gave you just a quick rundown of the fact that it's a multi-component site and shielded from dangerous weather, but it's also known as a large aggregation site where in the late fall kind of more wild rice harvesting periods, it is a huge aggregation site where people will come and all together, and it's described as this kind of cosmopolitan area where tribes other than just Anishinaabe, including like the Wendat, also known as the Huron, will come together and meet and do communal fishing and communal harvesting and importantly, ceremony. There are a lot, I won't be going over that in this presentation, but there are some sacred animal burials at this site as well, really truly showing how important over time this kind of gathering spot was for people. And it was seasonally occupied. Off on the corner actually are a couple of the types of fur trade artifacts that I found. So we got our copper tinkling cone and then blue cobalt beads. Other things to know about the Cloudman site is there is a pretty diverse subsistence system there. Generally speaking, sites like this, there will be storage. So there'll be cache pits where food will be stored, usually dried berries or, you know, dried wild rice. Like I said, it's not occupied in the winter time. People will move further south for that. And there's some small scale food production, but primarily foraging in this area. Big focus on wild rice, on the fish spawns, primarily whitefish, and mast producing trees, so acorn. Real quick, just because this is gonna, you know, maybe be a little bit important later, I want to give you a heads up on what I'm talking about when I say the French period. So it dates from about 1600, usually 1615, because that's when Etienne Brulé was the first one to come into Michigan, the first Frenchman that we actually have any documentation of. But it is by Dean Anderson's kind of thought process and research broken up into a few different phases. I just want you guys to know that so that when I reference that later talking about the kinds of plants, you know what I'm talking about. So this is a period in which first occupied by Odawa, which are, you know, Anishinaabe people and some Huron, eventually they're meeting French people. There is, unfortunately, a Seneca kind of war that happens. There's some removal, but people do come back to the island. Just because the occupational history, I don't want you to be under the impression that it's absolutely continuous. There is like a 50-ish year period where, because of war with the Seneca, the island was not occupied, but it does become reoccupied very quickly after that in 1670. And just for fun, because, you know, I'm into the fur trade, what we end up getting is a sort of shift of the like main Odawa core, where villages during this fur trade do generally move in closer to this Mackinac region near St. Ignace and Michilimackinac. But importantly, with dating done by previous work by like Susan Koyman, the Drummond Island is on a main fur trade site, a canoe route. And so it does have a very important geographic place in that history. Okay, so the excavations. So the data for today that I'm talking about came from the 2019 excavations that I did for my dissertation fieldwork. Following excavations that were carried out in the 1990s by Michigan State, it was noticed that they were quite shallow deposits. So, you know, be it the late woodland, the historic period, or otherwise, they were very close together. And so I ended up following the methods laid out there where we did 5-centimeter arbitrary levels. And you can see the scattered 1990s units and then the ones that I put in. And with that, I was able to get 5 new units in 2019, excavated 18 new features, and was able to get 14 new C14 dates sent out to be able to actually fully pinpoint actual features that were like truly dated to one period and not the other, because with 5 centimeters as a level, the general fill ended up being a little bit mixed. So we were very lucky that we were able to get features that dated perfectly to different, different time periods. And from those, we were able to get 12 soil samples that were sent off for microfossil research. And those were accomplished by Dr. Mark Horrocks. And 29 of the 52 soil flotations that I took were selected to do macrobotanical analysis by me. And yeah, like I said, a focus on the features only because, well, you know, you don't wanna be working with mixed materials. Here's just some pictures of some of the features that we're talking about. And yeah, you can see how close to the surface everything is. So from that, obviously with the macrobotanicals, IDing to the genus level was first and foremost important. And then from there, the vast majority of the macrobotanicals were actually charred wood. So they were anthropological And from that, I not only also did the same thing that I did with seeds, where identifying it to the genus, but I also looked for a variety of different features for those woods. So vitrification, which demonstrates whether something was not cured before it was burned, vessel deformation. So if it was not fresh wood, if it was sitting around, looking at minimum diameter and then ring thickness. For the purposes of today, we're not going to be talking about those, but I just wanted you guys to know the extent of different knowledge that you can get about the wood landscape just from charcoal itself in anthropological research, which I'm very excited about. But primarily today, we're looking at what the plants and kind of their adaptive strategies can tell us about fire management systems. Okay. So, like I said, if we just are looking at the genus level information, there's quite a lot that we can get if we're thinking about indicator species. So the analysis of macrobotanicals and then, you know, the associated microfossils meant that I could think about an organism, whether it was present or absence usually implies something specific about the ecology of the landscape. For example, if there are a lot of trees that have high light requirements, that tells you this is more of an open forest, and it being successful and able to be, you know, grown and burned means that the environmental circumstances were right for that plant to thrive. Same thing goes with low light, you know, levels. So there's a reason why older forests ends up being primarily beech or maple, because they have a shade tolerance and can actually handle that. So all of those are kind of marked out in the analysis. In order to not only try to match them to a specific forest type, but primarily just thinking about the landscape and ecological factors going on, whether ground is disturbed, whether this is new growth forest, and whether or not these seem like young pioneer plants. And I have an example of just an herbarium sheet of Fraxinus, so ash, because it is one of the pretty intense pioneer species. So just an aside on anthropology, just because it's in my title and I figure I should tell you, it is the study of charred wood, though we often call it charcoal, even though charcoal is a different thing. What you can get from this is socio-ecological and economic kind of information, not only about firewood management itself, but exploitation of various resources in a given environment. And I bring that up because even though we're talking about Michigan, the concepts and the ecological, you know, methods used, including anthropology, are absolutely relevant to Florida. And so I wanted to just bring some of that in so that it's, yeah, relevant to you guys, and you can think about it from your own way. So it's not just northern woodlands all the way. So forest succession, other than so if we're taking light requirements and water requirements and we're putting those together, what that ends up indicating is where in a forest succession this environment might be. So you have a fire. First, you have your initial colonizing plants that come through. Then later, you'll end up kind of with grasses and perennials into your intermediate forest that is usually demarcated by very specific species. And then as things become mature, you get those shade tolerant plants that we mentioned before, and that is called a climax community. So if you have a climax community that's represented in your samples, you have a pretty good idea about whether or not people are, you know, kind of tending and managing the forest versus if you have any examples of any of those intermediate phases. So let me tell you the results of that. So first, none of the features that I excavated in the 2019 season were middle woodland. So I am going to just be talking about the various divisions of the late woodland period and historic period for these results, because my interest is comparing the forest management in the woodland period to changes in the historic period and what that might mean for the kind of, you know, cultural and political landscape. So that is what we're going to be doing, is kind of comparing those and thinking about any continuity of practices. So first, looking at the middle late woodland, which there's a lot of like social changes that happen. So we have to end up dividing the woodland period up into a few different things. And we don't, at least in my area, use Mississippian, because that's not, doesn't really show up that far north. Okay. So first, I want to show you the microfossil results. Here I organized, and these were both pollen and spores, and in some cases starch, organized them for the highest amount to the lowest. The last, like usually seven, were probably equal in line. So, you know, these are not completely exact, but in this, the overwhelming majority of the pollen was pine. Not surprised, because pine tends to spit out a lot of pollen, despite whether or not it has, you know, huge numbers or not. That's followed very closely by birch, which, let's remember birch, because that's going to come up in just a second, followed by grasses, and then bracken, eagle ferns, and so on and so forth, until you get into more of the like aquatic or wetland types, like cattail or a moonwort. The late woodland period compared to that, this is the period in which there is the most activity and occupation and more like intensive activity at the site. And so from there, we're looking at this also pine and grasses, but kind of surprisingly, fewer birch pollens in this particular time period, but the eagle bracken fern is higher. I'm going to repeat that again, just because I want to talk about that in detail later. And then finally, comparing that to the historic period, birch is back up there, is highly represented again, along with pine. Pine honestly does not, when you get into the wood, show up a lot in any of the hearths, so they're not using it, but it is something in the local environment that is contributing pollen to the soils, and then grasses and so on. So comparing those real quick, here's just a rundown of the wood ID. Maple, highly ubiquitous between every single period. It was also the most present in every single sample as well. Alnus, so alder tree, birch, Fraxinus, so ash, as well as oak, were the species, the taxa that were present in every single period in extremely high numbers. I will make one note about the prunus, so the stone fruit. Those were present in the two kind of back-to-back middle late woodland and historic periods, but those were only present in one sample in each period, and it was one fragment. So I just, because this is looking at it just in terms of presence and absence, I just wanted to throw that out there, that overwhelmingly the fragments were oak, maple, and birch in all of these. So back to our indicators. What does all of this mean? For me, it's very exciting because, okay, the abundance of very, you know, specific species with light requirements ends up actually meaning something very important for these periods. I kind of made a big deal talking about the bracken fern. Also, I called it eagle fern earlier because that's another name for it, because the macrobotanical specimens and the microfossils that were important for thinking about fire management were rubus, so this is raspberry, gallium, so bedstraw, ash, so Fraxinus, ulnus, birch, primarily because it's short-lived and can't really deal with shade. And in addition to that, if we're comparing some of the additional evidence from the microfossils, a lot of the grasses and asters are indications of open landscapes and a part of that kind of second to third range in forest succession. But primarily, I want to talk about that bracken fern and the birch, because birch, fascinatingly, in its kind of final, you know, form in a landscape, let me move forward so I can talk to you about that. It as a kind of a tree in a stand form only really lasts on its own untended for about 80 years. And then it very quickly within the natural forest succession gets taken over by other species. However, because of its requirements, you know, it needs a lot of space, it needs a lot of light. The fact that it is showing up over the course of hundreds of years, if this were a scenario in which there was natural forest progression and you know, no involvement of people whatsoever. Even if we, you know, try to think about natural forest fires occurring, overwhelmingly, the reoccurrence of birch trees means that there's continuous openings in the forest that are being created. And it matches that kind of pattern that I showed you at the very beginning, where it's like the ishgode to kind of birch stands to berry stands pattern shows up there. Let me back up. Let's see here, because I want to talk about the ferns. Actually, I'll just tell you about the ferns. But also, so I kind of, you know, spoiled the results a little bit at the beginning by talking about eagle fern, because those are one of the two main species that are very good indicators of fire being used. They're fire adapted. They're a kind of ground colonizing fern that pops up, and usually and specifically in the presence, or the, I guess, following the presence of fire. So obviously there were other species that tended to indicate this over the course of many years. The fact that there's disturbed ground at the site with gallium and whatnot, you know, we could write that off as the fact that, yeah, they're living at the site, you know, where they're actively living, it's probably cleared, but they are going and seeking very specific trees from the mesic forest and from specifically the younger forest, which means people are continuously practicing what we see ethnographically as intentional fire setting. And specifically, for my purposes and thinking about it, it's happening in the historic period as well as prehistoric period. So there was that gap in time of a few years where the Seneca had, you know, kind of moved people off and, you know, there was war. But when they returned, it seems that despite the fact that the Odawa were taking part as middlemen in the fur trade, primarily being hired out by their canoes and helping move goods across the landscape, the waters of Lake Michigan and the Huron are incredibly dangerous. There's reasons why there are, you know, important Manitou, you know, water spirits that are said to haunt those waters, because a lot of people die. And the Odawa had this kind of knowledge of the landscape to move people around. But in addition to that, in addition to those new activities, they still were using the same spot to continue their practices and maintain a certain level of subsistence that they carried on into the historic period. So essentially, the continuity of young forests I find very exciting, because it adds not just credence, but it's very good archaeological evidence of the longevity and the antiquity of these kinds of behaviors. And for the purposes of thinking about, you know, new and contemporary movements, having this data is very, it makes me very hopeful for the potential to learn from basically the ancestors and this data on how and what the landscape looked like based on the plants I'm seeing, and kind of the threshold of what we can expect if we're trying to recreate these landscapes. Because here's where we get into our broader impacts. There have been a lot of very weird and almost like racist pushback against tribal people's right to actually take part in their own subsistence. And by that, I mean that the Sault Ste. Marie tribe in particular, there was an environmental group that for whatever reason was deeply against the practice of fishing by the tribe, and just kind of put out a bunch of really false and misleading claims, despite the fact that, you know, most of the overfishing that's done is industrial fishing. And so there's not only having this data showing that no, traditional and, you know, sustainable practices were very clearly a thing, so that the public doesn't get misled about that and, you know, kind of confused and continue to contribute to that long history of ignoring Indigenous knowledge, but it also helps promote and protect the rights that are currently there. So I have a big map here that is showing in all the green, you know, inland harvest areas, and where, if you have tribal identification, you can currently collect. Let me flip to this one, because what this means is that this is a part of the 1836 ceded territory in Michigan. This is about 40% of the land area in Michigan, where 7 of the 12 federally recognized tribes in Michigan are allowed to collect wild foods on public lands. These are, you know, rights that were laid out by both the 1842 Treaty of La Pointe and 1836 Treaty of Washington. And just to highlight how important these rights are and the fact that they had to, but in the 2007 Inland Consent Decree, be reaffirmed legally in 2020 alone, the Sault Ste. Marie tribe, which is a tribe of like 60,000 people, it gave out almost 60,000 individual permits issued that year to do collection and harvesting on public lands and in forests to support themselves, not only economically, but spiritually and, you know, medicinally, because of the kind of medicinal elements that berries are thought to have. So let me flip to the next one. It's a really kind of promising set of data that, if I back up, means that we can continue to gain evidence and protect those sorts of activities, because it's obviously very useful, but we have obviously the major problem of lumber and, you know, lumber milling and environmental damage and pollution making a huge impact on the forests. And so showing what can be and creating more opportunities for groups to practice traditional fire management and fire ecology to help create more of these wild foods that can be harvested by people can only do good when we think about how it's being used and how it connects to food sovereignty as a larger contemporary movement. And, you know, these are just some examples of that. So in 2018, the Heritage Seeds for Sustainable Lifeways project specifically was thinking about museum collections and how we could use old seeds in our collections to maybe help promote those. So, future work, in addition. There's also the phytolith and starch data that is very promising for thinking about wild rice. And from this information, increased collaboration with tribal natural resource departments. So I currently have a data sharing agreement with the Fish and Wildlife Department for the Sault Ste. Marie tribe, but archaeology clearly has a very important place that we can play in a supporting role and communicating this data that we have and working with tribes to help, yeah, for larger food sovereignty and for the greater good, in addition to it just being very interesting for me in general. So I want to thank you all for listening to me ramble on for a while about seeds and wood. Miigwech, I want to acknowledge Barbara and Gary Cloudman, the site owners, for being very kind in allowing generations of archaeologists to dig on their land. Obviously, my entire committee, I should be thanking you guys for inviting me. It was very amazing. The Museum of Anthropological Archaeology, and yeah, all my human and non-human relatives, including the plant relatives that I was able to study for this. So thank you all. And if there are any questions, I'm happy to answer them. I'm going to stop sharing, but I can reshare it if there are specific questions.
Outside. Oh, no, that's fine. You can leave it like that. If you have any questions, you can unmute. I know I have a couple, but I'll give other folks a chance. Does anybody have a question besides me? Okay, well, I'll go ahead and start. First of all, how did you decide where to put your excavation units in?
Oh, that was so the where was easy because they actually had a pre-planned out grid. And there was cemented in the 90s a metal pole with a concrete cap that marked datum 3. So I was able to pull off the grid that they had marked from datum 3 and basically find what areas of the site were promising for more historic features and just found through some kind of quick shovel testing where those blocks were and put in my units right off the edges of those units.
Okay, so did you encounter artifacts as you were digging along with the,
yes,
the botanical? Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Oh yeah. So there's also a ton of ceramic and lithic data among, you know, the fur trade item. Gotcha. But yeah, I tend to, you know, obsess over the underappreciated things like pieces of wood.
No, I think it's phenomenal that you get so excited about this. It's just absolutely wonderful. It was a wonderful presentation. My other question was, did you encounter any extinct species?
So yes and no, in that passenger pigeon, yes, is an extinct species and is, you know, widely used and shows up.
I mean plant species.
Oh, plant species. Yes. No extinct plant species. It's primarily fish that have been extinct and then reintroduced into the Great Lakes and other like land small-bodied animals, but no extinct plants, thank goodness. Unless you consider very specific types of corn that are no longer grown extinct, then yeah, sure.
And so you, when you talk about the museum collections, you're talking mm-hmm. about going into trying to propagate seeds that are currently being curated in museums.
So yeah, so that was a part of a separate project that I was an intern for, where I'm trying to figure out how far along it's been now. Basically, some of our collections dated back to the 1930s when they were collected, and they were corn from tribes in, you know, northern Michigan, and then also kind of like grow out corn from the Southwest. But later in the 2000s, oh my gosh, Scott Heron ended up doing ethnographic work, and some of the seeds he collected from like Walpole Island and nearby, he gave to us in our collections. And so the entire Heritage Seeds Project was primarily part one, like just being transparent about the kinds of items that we have, because there are a ton of varieties of corn that are almost totally extinct in the world and are only exist in museum collections. And that project was trying to think about whether or not any of those seeds could be grown out and what like the science behind that could be, because that had been successfully done in a totally different, you know, region of the US with squash seeds and some of the giant squash seeds. And so that was a not only intertribal kind of group that kind of came through, it was also inter-university, and the USDA a member was there, and the a member of the indigenous tribal agricultural council all came together to kind of have a massive discussion about this and what kind of protocols we could kind of create, or a memorandum of agreement on how to move forward with using our collections for that. And some of the samples of corn from Walpole from the 2000s were used as like a test study to grow those out. And so as far as I know, I'm pretty sure that those initial pilot tests for growing out the 2000s corn were successful. And so now we're in a really weird spot where we're not really sure where to go from here, or, you know.
Interesting. Super interesting. Yeah. That's awesome.
And I got to give Lisa Young a lot of credit for that project. That's her brainchild mostly.
Oh, great. Let me see here if I can. Everybody, if you have questions, you can unmute yourselves while I try to.
So yeah, what future research you would be curious as to kind of taking a look at and where you want to go forward kind of from here.
Yeah. So because this has been a somewhat intensively studied site, there's been some interesting kind of overlaps between the stuff that I'm doing and previous stuff. So Susan Koyman had done residue analysis on a bunch of the ceramics. Problem being is that for this historic period, there are almost no ceramics that date to that at the site. So there's an incredibly robust data set on things that people were literally cooking in their pots, but for all the prehistoric stuff. Mm-hmm. But what was interesting in that is that there were wild rice phytoliths that were found in the ceramics, but no wild rice starch. But in my samples, there was wild rice starch. So it kind of creates this interesting question of, okay, the interpretive potential of what we know about rice phytoliths right now is kind of lacking. And mm-hmm. so there needs to be a giant body of experimental data that we need to create to do comparisons with what we have archaeologically. So the next steps for me that I'm very excited about is trying to do some experimental archaeology with wild rice processing. So the various, you know, parching and winnowing processes to see when we sample after that's been done, what kind of phytoliths or starch show up as a result of those activities, so that we can try to better understand just activities happening at the site and where it's happening on the landscape, and are they moving it here? Are they actually collecting it here? You know,
that's fantastic. That's awesome.
Anybody else have a question?
Yeah, I did. So in terms of the controlled burns, it sounds like to keep open spaces and propagate certain trees, are you saying that essentially part of what they were doing was burning? I'm thinking particularly of birch trees and all the uses of birch bark, not just for canoes, but baskets and all kinds of things. Is that part of the hypothesis that you're...
Yeah. So not only do I know that they were using birch because it shows up in all of the, you know, various hearths and different features, but the fact that it's there implies that it's not, obviously we know ethnographically it's incredibly important, but it also implies that that's something that they were intentionally thinking about when they were burning areas of like old growth pine to make room for more birch to grow. Because as you noted, birch is used for all kinds of things. And it's also one of the types of wood that's really important for very ceremonial fires where you burn, you know, just the various parts of bark because of the oils in it. And so what I can fully and carefully say based on the data is we know that it's very unlikely that birch stands used over the course of hundreds of years would have stayed in this one island within the catchment on its own for that long without any human involvement. But also they are burning it and it's showing up in my sample. So it's clearly important and at least abundant enough that they're not, you know, they're not just keeping it for all this other special purposes. Because the fact that like you'd be burning it in a regular fire for wood does in some ways imply that you at least have enough of it, that it's not something that you have to be very careful and stingy about, if that makes sense. I hope I answered your question. I feel like there was two parts to your question. I only answered the first part.
That'll do. Thank you.
Okay.
Thanks.
Does anybody else have any questions? That's it. Well, Elspeth, that was really fascinating. And, you know, I think a lot of people might think of this as kind of a dry topic if you're not familiar with it, but you made it so interesting. And it's just so delightful to see that you have truly found your calling. You are so excited about your research and it really showed in your presentation. And it was very enlightening. Even though it, and I especially like how you made connections to, you know, to Florida and what we see here. So thank you so much for taking time out to present to us. We really appreciate it.
It'd be cool to see similar things in Florida that I can compare and see. How far does this go? You know.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Thanks for listening to me ramble.
Thank you so very much. And. To thank you for your time, we will be sending you a past t-shirt that you can proudly wear when the weather warms up again, because it's going to be colder up there.
I can always wear it with a cardigan, you know?
Well, there you go. There you go. Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much, Elspeth. This was a really interesting talk. We really appreciate it. And thank you, everybody, for joining us. And hopefully we'll see some of you in person next month. And hopefully Marty will bring you to Tallahassee one of these days so you can see his site where he's working.
Yeah.
Very cool. All right, everybody. Thank you again. Take care. Bye-bye.